You waking me up. I do my hair, toss, check
my nails. Baby, how you feeling? I must have forgot to add money on this month. Come on. I'm a single mom.
I am too.
You are? How old's your kid?
Bye.
Safe driving out there. Your essay is due tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just gonna write it for you.
You're such a good tutor.
I don't want that much. That's a lot.
It's too much.
Hello.
Hi. Get naked.
Yes, ma'am.
Hey, Bridge, you know Hard Nipples Nelson, college sportscaster? That's your baby daddy, right?
No, he wouldn't date someone this cheesy.
Hi!
It's so nice to meet you. You look so different than in your photos. It's like a gritty quality. I try.
You should get out more. I'll babysit for you.
Ma'am, can I help you with something?
You know, I've always wanted to learn how to use one of those.
Okay.
Sometimes you still act like a kid.
I don't mean to.
I know, it's okay, honey. You'll be you, okay?
You're my best friend. You know,
for a tutor.
I gotta be a role model.
Can you pass me the knife? Here you go.
I need Larry to see you kick some butt.
Who has big balls?
I do! Oh!
Go!
We should do this another time when he's not around.
He's always around.
I mean, you're doing a really great job with him. It's really impressive.
She scores, the crowd goes wild.
What? Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's my stuff. That's my... Wait. Hey, get back here. I'm a single mom.
Writer, creator, producer, director, and star of Showtime's new hit show, SMILF. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That is amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's go back to the beginning. You made a short film. Mm-hmm. It won an award at Sundance, yeah. Right? What made you make the short film?
I actually wrote a script first, so I was sick of being a broke actress in LA with a toddler, and I thought if I wrote a script, I could then get staffed on a TV show as a writer. So I wrote...
You wrote like a feature script?
I wrote a pilot.
Oh, pilot.
And then I ended up getting work as an actor, so didn't need to try to go get staffed, and thought, oh, I still want to try to develop this as a show. But I also knew that what I write on the page might not necessarily translate to film. Like, people wouldn't necessarily see how I saw it just by reading it. So I thought if I directed a scene from that pilot, it would help me sell the show. And that ended up being a short, SMILF, which then went to Sundance and won an award, which then in turn, because of the attention it got as a short, helped me sell the show.
So it's
like the circular thing, yeah.
Now, can I ask, was the short that you... That was very nice. If you guys want to clap,
yeah,
go
no.
ahead. I will allow it.
Yeah.
When you made the short, did it take place in Boston in the short as well?
It actually was just a scene where a girl who hadn't had sex since her kid was born. The original pilot did. It sort of went back and forth, actually. And in the short, she was wearing a Red Sox shirt, but it was nondescript. And we shot it for $3,000 in my friend's room.
Wow.
Yeah, but it became clear that having the show take place in Boston was really important and that Boston would play a character in the show as well.
Why is that?
I think just dealing with class issues, it's, you know, obviously very important that we're in a sort of lower income area. And I feel like our TV is saturated with LA stories.
Yeah.
And my family is from Boston and I grew up going to Southie every weekend and I grew up outside of Boston. And there just seemed like a lot more richer storytelling if we, and also, you know, we all see The Departed and other sort of gangster Boston stories, and there's this other side to it, and where we could focus on the women that I feel like we haven't necessarily seen in TV or movies.
It's true. Boston has always been a very male-dominated city in how it's portrayed in pop culture.
Yeah. And the thing about the women, and like, they're all kind of crazy. Like, my family's all kind of crazy, but they come together in a crisis.
Yeah.
And that's, like, there's, like, really loyal, and there's this sense of family that, I don't know, it's, like, very proud town. And so that was something that was, it's also woven through the show as well.
Yeah, it's like, he killed five people, but he's family. What
right.
are you going to do? He's
right.
family. Yeah.
But there's also this adage of, like, who do you think you are?
Yeah.
Like, leaving town, you know? Like, there's also that sort of dynamic, too, where Bridgette... the character I play in the show feels like an outsider, you know?
Do you feel like an outsider when you go back?
Yeah, I mean, my mom's Irish Catholic. She raised me Jewish. She raised me in Brookline, which was like this sort of more affluent town, but we had no money. Mm-hmm. So there was like all these, and then I went to Barnard here, which is a great school. I'd come back, you know, and decided to be an actor. I'd come back for the holidays. My family's like, where's your Oscar, huh? So like always sort of never totally fitting in, you know?
It's a weird feeling.
Yes, it is a weird feeling, yeah.
So you're from Brookline?
Mm-hmm.
I'm from Western Massachusetts.
Oh, where?
So like Amherst, Northampton.
Oh, it's beautiful there.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, that's cool.
I like that area a lot.
Basketball was created in Springfield.
Yes, we have the Basketball Hall of Fame.
Yeah,
you know what else was created in that area?
What?
Volleyball was created in Holyoke.
Really? Oh, really?
So yeah.
They're like competing towns.
Yeah, Springfield won that one.
Yeah, for sure.
Apparently there's a Volleyball Hall of Fame in Holyoke. I've never seen it.
A volleyball what? Hall of Fame, yeah. Only go to the basketball one.
Do you even know a name? I wouldn't know a name.
No, that's soccer. I was going to say Mia Hamm. I don't know. Yeah.
So after you got there, we'll move off of volleyball.
Yeah, okay.
After you sell the pilot.
Yeah.
What was it like when they told you, is this what you asked for, to basically be kind of running your show and starring in it? And because you're directing episodes,
yeah.
You're writing episodes, a fairly small writer's room,
Yeah.
From what I see on IMDb.
Yeah, you know, I was always going to be in it. I was in the short.
Yeah.
And then I directed the pilot. So that sort of had me, like, I had to sort of, I think every step of the way was a process of proving myself. And I had them put in my contract that I was directing the pilot when we were going around pitching. So that was sort of non-negotiable wherever we were going to sell it. And then in terms of the show running aspect, I think because it's such a specific voice or specific story that also Showtime is just incredible. They're such great partners. So they never proposed someone running it with me. They just always assumed that I would do it.
Right.
And so it really was learning on the go because a lot of that job is management. You know, you're dealing with the budget, you're dealing with the schedule, which is something, it's like this weird part of being a writer where as you go up, as you move up the ladder, eventually you get this job, which has nothing to do with writing, you know?
It's like, hey, this location dropped out for tomorrow. Do you think we could change the scene to this?
Right.
And like, so could you have a writer write that?
Right, yeah. Or like we're over budget, so how do you move this scene that's on location onto the stage? Or you needed to get,
How do you do that when you're like in the makeup chair, you're like about to go on set to do a scene?
I mean, literally, well, in the makeup trailer, I have like
that's where you do your work.
That's where I'm like always like, you know, have my computer, have my assistant. It really was constant, you know, and it just has to be. But yeah, I don't know. You just do it. You just get
you're
it.
You're also a mom too, right?
I am a mom. I know, Isaac. My son is 9. I told him we got a second season, but I'm like, don't worry, I get more time this time. So, and he's in the show. He plays Connie Britton's son.
Oh wow!
So last night. In last night's episode, yeah. The kid at the table, where I'm like, yeah, it's hard. It's bad enough that Larry has to split his time between two houses. And he's like, that sounds horrible. That was like a meta moment, because that's what he has to do.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you talk to him about the line and everything beforehand? Did he get the joke?
He's really smart, little guy. And that was actually something that I decided, that I wrote on the spot. And he was like, sure, I'll do it. He thought it was funny.
When you went out to LA to act, did you want to initially be a writer and a director first? Was that your primary goal?
I feel like, so I went to school at Barnard, and that's where I was, I was playing basketball my whole life. I got to New York, hadn't really been exposed to any of the arts. I was just like this, it was very insular existence of just playing basketball.
Yeah.
And then when I got
to- Are you good?
I mean, I got a nice jump shot, some handle. But when I got to New York, sort of the whole world opened up in terms of, I worked at Kim's Video, I started watching movies. Like, it just, I thought I might be a photographer, but I didn't really know how to be in the business of movie making aside from being an actress. So I thought that's what I had to do. As I started working as an actor, it became very clear that I wanted to be in control of what was going on. But I just didn't know. I guess my training was just like doing a bunch of terrible little indie movies. And then it was like, then I'm like, I have to
There's
make it.
A couple
it.
Good ones
no,
in there.
No, they're not all bad. No, I love all you directors who I worked with. But anyway, thank you. So, you know, I did write a script to graduate. I needed one credit, and that was sort of my first thing that I wrote, and that stayed in the drawer. But it actually had similar themes, you know, like South Boston, young girl struggling, who, like, ended up falling in love with a vet.
Oddly fine, as much as you think you're progressing as a writer, that, like, 10, 15 pages into a script, you're like, oh, I'm writing the same thing.
We all have one story to tell. Yeah, we just find different ways.
Variations on it over and over again.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But I think that is a part, like a sort of gendered thing. At least when I was at the age of figuring out what I wanted to do, I really didn't have these role models that you see young film students have of, I want to be Spielberg or Scorsese or whatever. I just didn't connect like that. And so I remember falling in love with Jane Campion. And it's not that you have to identify with someone of your own gender, but,
no, but there's
stories.
There's certain stories, plus there's a tone, there's a different directorial eye.
Yeah.
And it helps when someone is, I think men just take it for granted. We have no idea what it's like because
right.
Culture is inundated with this, with powerful auteur men.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, like you're the model. So we have to either insert ourselves into the male model or sort of find a different way in. And I think that was probably the reason it took a little while for me to sort of claim this is what I wanted to do. Because I do feel more of a director than any of the other roles that I play.
Did you have trouble shutting down your directorial instincts? Were you on a lot of these indie films and on TV shows?
Oh, yeah,
shows
I did
too?
One film where in Texas, tiny little movie, where the director would call me, would say, like, why don't you ask the little director? You know, I'm like, wouldn't it be easier if we, you know, just trying to make the day go faster? I know.
You would be doing that too?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Not my proudest moment, but it was there, you know, so now I get to do it.
So now you're on the set and you're working with someone like, you know, Rosie O'Donnell, mm-hmm. who is amazing on this show. And I don't think she's really been on a show or in a movie in quite some time.
Yeah.
What was your pitch to get her?
I mean, that was sort of dumb luck, you know, because there's a lot of women of that age who are looking to work. And so I met with a bunch of people. We actually were talking with someone else and she hurt herself. And then my casting director suggested Rosie. And in my mind, you know, there was, you know, beautiful girls and there was a league of their own, but she'd been hosting for so long. So I didn't totally see it at first. And we FaceTimed. I was already in Boston. And there's something, I mean, she's one of many children of an Irish Catholic, like, poor household. So there was that, like, automatic connection. And then she said, you know, Frankie, I just want to disappear into a role. And she named her favorite shows, which were my favorite shows. And there was just, like, an immediate connection artistically. And it's, I mean, it is beyond anything I could have imagined. She's so easy and fun and exhilarating to work
She's
with.
She's so good, too.
So good.
I know you're here, and it sounds like I'm just saying that, but when I watched the show, the first time I watched the show and she came on, it was within a minute, you're like, holy shit, Rosie O'Donnell is so great.
Yeah, she's just, like, tapped in.
She's just really charismatic. Like,
and so
she has
beautiful.
That thing.
I know. And I think, too, like, Rosie O'Donnell in the public eye, because of her feud with Trump, has taken on a persona, and people assume this, like, gruffness.
And because of The View and, you know,
The View, right, exactly. But, like, she's so sensitive and thoughtful, and so I think it's sort of just, like, reminding people. Like, people, like, forget that that's who she is, too. And she gets to display those characteristics in this character. Yeah, I love her.
What's been the hardest job for you in terms of directing this show and starring in it and producing and writing it? What have you had the most, I don't want to say trouble with, because you're doing an amazing job. You would never glean that there's been trouble of any kind. But what have you found that, like, this is just this thing that's really hard to do?
You know, so we had this truncated schedule where we started writing in June. We started production in August, and we had to air November 5th. So we basically wrote all the episodes in 8 weeks and then didn't have much prep. And so I would say it was really took singular focus.
How many writers?
We had about eight. And there was about three other writers who really did most of the work with me. Mm-hmm. Because it was such a fast process, we really had to just, like, get it done, you know? And so I would say that was probably the hardest thing, and which is goes into why I told my son we'll have more time, you know, because it was really just like every second of the day I was making the show.
Was it hard making the show and, you know, not having the time for your son?
Yeah.
And I don't mean that as a gendered question, but
it can be gendered. I mean, I feel like every parent would feel devastated by not having dinners with your kid because you're editing after shooting. But
it is a question that, for whatever reason, is rarely asked of men, right. And it's a strange thing.
Totally. I mean, there are showrunner stories where men purposely work late to not see their families. You hear that stuff. You know, they just have a FaceTime relationship with their kids, which is not how I am with Isaac. And so, yeah, it's terrible. And so, I mean, yeah, I'm not going to lie. It was not really difficult. But what I told him was, like, it's such a short time. And then the time I did have with him was, like, very focused and all about him, and the phone was away and all that. And it's something that I've said, like, now we have the season two and we can, we will keep normal hours.
I also think if it's something that you talk to your kid and explain to them what's going on and the opportunity itself and what's been presented, like, they might not fully understand, but they'll grasp it a little bit.
He's like, at the same time where he's like, Mom, oh, what again? You know, I come home at 9 and just cuddle with him or whatever it is. He's also so proud and comes to set. I mean, I wrote him a part so he could be on set and sees me running the set. And I feel like that is so valuable for this young boy, seeing his mom have this, like, very demanding job, you know? I think it's like it gives him a sense of empowerment too.
What's the most difficult thing in terms of representing South Boston and you know, a low income neighborhood? What is the most difficult thing about that responsibility?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're actually gonna, I'm thinking about season two stories and getting into the gentrification, because no one can actually afford to live in Southie anymore, you know? And it's just, you can't talk about class without getting involved and talking about politics and talking about race. And, you know, part of it is just giving, trying to make these characters as three-dimensional as possible. And also, like, the struggle is very real for a lot of people, but it's not sad. I feel like the people who live on, like, the higher socioeconomic level are the ones would say, oh, it's so sad. You know, it's like we all find, like, yeah, it's a struggle, but there's levity there, you know, because that's what we do as humans. We find the laughter. And I think that's what's the most important thing is, like, yeah, a lot of TV shows, it's like fancy townhouses, you know, and this is
even when they're supposed to be like struggling. A single mom or something, totally. They live in like a friend style loft.
Yeah, and those are great shows, you know, but so it's like, how do we, you know, have cockroaches running around and not be some, you know, I don't know, exploiting poverty. Like, I don't want it to be some voyeuristic thing either. So I think that's important.
Last night, what's so interesting, in this last night's episode, right, where you do the Run Lola Run homage, well, actually, how many people here know what Run Lola Run is?
Yeah, okay, so like 5 or 6.
That makes me love that you did it even more.
When we were writing the episode, we were like, no one is going to get this.
Well, what I like even more about it is this idea that we're representing South Boston here. Run Lola Run homage.
A German movie.
So how did that come about?
Well, it actually, a Run Lola Run reference was written for a different episode, just like one, like half of a page. It was going to be where we switched perspectives into Raffi, and we were going to, anyways, at the end of episode 4, there's a big fight outside of Dunkin' Donuts, and that used to be the top of episode 5, where there's a little reference. And then that story got thrown out, and so we had to quickly think of a new story because we were shooting in 3 weeks. And so we were like, what if we just did this run? It was either going to be a satire parody of gangster movies in Boston, or we were going to do this Run Lola Run, which maybe we'll do the gangster one next season. But yeah, it was just sort of a thing where we just all got excited about this idea. And then I think the reason why it can still resonate, even though a lot of you guys have never seen Run Lola Run, is that it stays in the story of the characters. So the emotions are consistent based on where we are with, you know, with each of the characters. So it stays sort of grounded.
It also feels like you're using it not entirely, but partially as a reference to how a single mom has to run around from responsibility to responsibility and family member to family member. And there's like a constant ticking clock.
Right. And also, you know, we were really we were trying to really dig into this theme of forgiveness and how ultimately, like, you're stuck with the family that you have, and if you can make it work by forgiving them, that's ideal, you know, that's the ideal. So, like, what if, it's just sort of like sliding doors. What if she did this? What if she, and then at the end, she sort of learns that lesson.
The show has a obviously a very singular voice because you're so involved in every element of it, but how did you go about finding other writers for the writers' room, knowing that they would kind of match up with your voice?
My husband is one of the writers on the show.
Oh, wow.
So that's incredible. He wrote last night's episode.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. How do you guys work together?
We actually, it was like a big debate whether we were going to do it. And it's been seamless and amazing, and thank God, because he's been there. I probably wouldn't have talked to him for 5 months if he hadn't worked on the show.
Does he ever argue with your ideas? He goes, yep, mm-hmm, got it, honey.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because there's a power dynamic there that we have to be really careful, you know, navigating. Yeah. And he's amazing to work with. And I always, they're like, but the best idea wins, you know? So it doesn't like have to be, there doesn't have to be ownership over it. But there's definitely like a sense, like a feeling in the show if something is working or not. And like, I think that the key was getting people sort of in tune with that sort of tone, you know?
How would you define that tone?
It's really a mixture, you know? It's, you know, there's like some real grounded emotional moments and situations. And then, you know, we go off into like absurdist fantasy,
yeah.
You know, like Beauty and the Beast dancing in the middle of a date, like that kind of thing. And so the tone is that it's an undefined tone in a way that maybe Baskets has its own tone. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that show on FX that I love. It was actually the existence of that show was like, oh, I guess we can just do
whatever we want.
Yeah, like there's sort of this new age of television is redefining TV. So, yeah, that was part of it.
The structure is the time of the show, like how long the
show
is.
We have 28 minutes and 30 seconds to tell a story. And each episode I feel like is sort of a mini movie surrounded, like, you know, based on a theme. So that's sort of how we approached it. This one's about forgiveness. This one's, you know, about like selling your body, right? The relationship with the way our society objectifies women. Yeah. And so that was episode 3. So each one was like, how do we tell the story based on this like theme that we're interested in exploring?
Let's get some questions from the audience. Who has a question right here?
Hi. Hey. The first thing I saw you in, which really made me a fan, was Blue Mountain State. I'm just a huge fan.
Oh,
of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's so funny, though, because when I started watching this, a lot of times you think it's going to be something similar to what you've seen them do. And this, like, that was total dude humor. And this is, like, the complete opposite of that.
This is the feminist.
Exactly,
version.
Yeah. But when I was watching this show, one thing that was interesting to me, and also in the short, was your decision to have girls play your son. So I was wondering what made you make that decision. Have you already started thinking about what you may have to do in the future?
Yeah, for sure. So the girls are Anna and Lexa, these twin girls playing my son Larry. And they were just the ones, I probably met with thousands of toddlers, two-year-olds, when I was trying to find my kid. And they just were the most fun to work with. They were captivating. They were smart. They listened. Their parents are great. It was like, because you're also auditioning the parents and you're casting children. And so for that, it was like just getting through the pilot. Like we needed, because the kid isn't so much. And it's a gamble, you know? And then, so now I'm thinking maybe one day if we get, you know, future seasons, knock on wood, they're going to wake up one day and say, Mom, I was born in the wrong body. And then we'll start dressing them like girls so we don't mess them up too much. Yeah, so that's the plan.
I have not seen Blue Mountain State.
Oh, yeah.
What is Blue Mountain State?
It's a dude bro misogynist show on Spike TV. That was so, it was like my first series regular job, and I was the one girl character cheerleader. And it was funny because I'm a, you know, feminist, went to Barnard, and my first job, and this is when Isaac was 2, and I was like, thank God
I have
a job. So I did it, but it was definitely, I was like, this is so ironic that I'm like I like the scene in episode 3 where I have to pad my bra with the chicken cutlets. Like there was a time on Blue Mountain State where I forgot to put them in, and they're like, "Hold production," and they like came in and had my padded bra for me. But it was I learned a lot. It was so fun. I love those guys. But the philosophy of the show is definitely not my philosophy. But there's a lot of fans.
Was it weird doing it? Or were you just sort of like,
I was like, I just don't want to get fired. Yeah. I was like, I mean, it was my first job. I was just like, I remember being like, how do I make this a real person? Mm-hmm. So I thought, and the character was super hyper-sexualized, drunk, kind of. So I was like, what if it was a girl who...
hyper-sexualized, drunk.
Pretty much, right? A cheerleader. She was nuts. So it was super fun to play. And I was like, what if she... I remember being like, she's like Abed from Community, but like learned, everything she learned is from like late night Cinemax. So like that was like my rationale when I was playing the character. So yeah, so to try to give her some substance, I know.
Next question.
Hi, so did your vision for the show change like when you were starting to write for the show as opposed to when you did the short film?
Yeah, you know, it originally was in Boston, and then through development it went to LA, and then it moved back to Boston. And originally, actually, the baby daddy and the girlfriend weren't part of it. It was just, she was alone, struggling, single mom. She had a best friend, and she was, like, scrappy, and she was a tutor. So some of the elements are still there. And then through development, talking about my relationship with my son's dad and his wife, people are like, oh, that's so fascinating. What is it like to co-parent?
Aren't you guys, you're pretty close,
we're
right?
We're super close.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, like they were in my wedding. And
he was just in a, weren't you in a movie or were oh, she in a short film?
Yeah, so Teresa Palmer, she's an actress, Australian actress. So she was in one of my shorts. And she's, I'm trying to figure out where to put her in the show for next year.
Oh, that's so cool.
But yeah, we're super close. So that sort of became, but it's not without its challenges, you know? And so... that became an important part of the show, so that's different. Yeah, so it's sort of a mixture.
Did that take time to get to that point after, or were you guys pretty quickly like, eh?
So much time. Yeah. A lot of work, a lot of family meetings. This is how I feel when this happens. But like we, you know, it's all...
good, it's mature, it's responsible.
Because yeah. It's for Isaac, because we want, you know, he needs to feel like we're a cohesive team, so yeah. I mean, that's what's fun about the show, too, is getting to write this character of Nelson as my friend and not my enemy. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question. Right there.
Hi. I'm a huge fan of SMILF and, frankly, everything you stand for. I had a quick question. So we spoke about Rosie O'Donnell, but Connie Britton is also a really strong...
Oh, I'm so sorry, I forgot. Yeah, she's amazing. Sorry.
Yeah, wasn't calling you out. But those are two really powerful guest stars and co-stars. Do you have anyone that you're killing to have for season 2?
Oh, my God. I mean, that's such a hard question. I wish I could have a better answer. We have a list of people that we love, you know, we try to write for. There's a couple people that immediately come to mind. I worked with Tatiana Maslany, and she's the best actor living today. So writing her a part would be great.
That's true. Did you see her in Stronger?
Yeah.
She's like, yeah.
She's great.
Give her the ball. She's amazing.
I know. Yeah, she's incredible. She's somebody... and I actually played her sister in Stronger.
Oh, wait, I'm so sorry. You did. I'm so sorry.
No. It's a tiny part. I'm there for 2 seconds. I'm like, do I say anything? But anyways, sorry.
I saw the movie. I did an interview. I'm so sorry.
But so we've talked about bringing her in. Yeah.
No, let's wrap it up, guys.
Yeah. but I would like to give you better answers. I don't know.
That was great.
Okay.
There was an episode scene in last night's episode where Connie Britton's character asks you if you're willing to swing with her.
Yeah.
And her husband. I loved your character's response to that, which is she could do nothing but focus on the practicalities of that because her life is so based on practicals. But is that gonna come back, or was that just like a one-off joke?
Yeah, there's definitely a story there, you know.
It was such a great addition to the character.
Yeah, it was so fun to like have the neurotic spin out, you know, because that's not what you assume is going to be the answer. or to that question, it's the answer is usually, yeah, sure, when? I'll hook up with you, Connie Britton. but yeah, we're definitely going to dig deeper into Connie's whole world and story.
I also loved the way that she talked about her husband sexually, which was, he's fun. He's gentle. He's fun.
He's really kind.
Yeah. Frankie, I love the show. Thank you so much for being here. I apologize about the stronger thing.
Oh, no. I do not care at all.
The show is on Sunday nights on Showtime. How many more episodes do we have left of this first season?
We have three more left.
Three more left.
Yeah, and actually I'm going to plug the finale because it's playing on please. New Year's Eve. So, but they're starting it a couple days early, but you know, streaming and all that on demand. But actually Bridgette, who doesn't use Tinder or date basically the whole season, finally signs up for Tinder and swipes right on her dad. So it's a date with her dad, folks. So tune in.
Frankie Shaw, everybody.
Yeah.